Good morning. We are going to start it early today because this chapel, 12:30, there's one more event. So I want to honor all the people that who are helping this make it happen. So I want to thanks everyone to come in again. And this is the third part of our Getting the Love You Want. And I think we have a couple of the kind of a bullet point I want to bring back to everyone. It's that we talk about recognitions, that healing of your childhood wound is the hidden purpose of your love, lasting relationship. If you didn't take a look at your childhood wound, it's very difficult because your partner cannot read your mind. Your partner cannot be the person who will make you happy. And that's the whole purpose, is to recognize each one of us when we struggle during our childhood, and then also being hurt and not being heard, and that will impact on our current relationship. Then second one is a more, create a more accurate picture of your partner. So maybe that you have a projection, you feel like your partner is going to save you, but actually, your partner just want to really stand by you and help you to deal with your struggle, deal their own struggle. And so you guys have a more clear picture. So we should not really expecting that the other person that it's going to just like listen and do nothing. And I think that's not really the truth. Number three, conscious effort. Taking responsibility to communicate your needs to your partner. And I think it's that do not assume and do not expect. I think it's more what I want, what I need. I think this is the good part. And if your partner can communicate with you in that truthful, honest way, then you both earn this relationship and respectfully. And then the fourth bullet point I want to make is that you are more become intentional in your interaction with your partner. So you are not just kind of a lashing out anger. You are not just kind of a making like a joke, but you know that poke your partner's wound. I think you will make a really conscientious effort, intentionally just say, how do I make my love to, like the really make them understanding where I come from. So the intentions, the everything. So it's not just a really, just want to problem solving at that moment. But it's really intention. Just like I always have a rule is that I don't want to say something I'm going to regret the rest of my life. And that's my conscientious effort. No, I'm not going to say it, even though I'm so angry, but I am not going to say that. Then number five is prioritizing your partner's needs as that highly as your own. Because they have a life and dream and goal. You have your life and dream and goal. It's by how you guys complement each other. I will help you. You will help me. And then you both build up that. And then number six is embracing the dark side of your personality, the negativity traits that you have. I think we are not perfect. Like if you ask my husband, he will say, oh, you talk too fast, too loud. Can you slow down and be soft? I say, I'm not Japanese girl, you know? Over the years, I learned talk slow with my husband, talking soft with my husband. And I really do that because I know I have a negative side. Sometimes if you really got me going, I will use theology, I will use psychology, I will just on purpose want to beat you down. My husband say, hold off, I'm not your enemy here. We want to communicate, remember? So just embrace that we all have that negative side. That's a part of us we cannot really erase. And then number 7 is learning how to the new technique to meet your own needs and desire and rather depend on solely on your partner. I think it's true, we want to grow up and grow older with our partner, but our part is not hold on to it. No, it's our own. God gave us a purpose. It's our own purpose to grow. And that's the key. And then number 8 is that really I want you guys to remember we talk about here a lot is identify your strength. Either is that you can really knowing that this is my strength, or maybe you are lacking of this strength and you would like to develop them on them. I think this is good. Like if you are very shy person and you don't like to talk, and oftentimes your partner have to fishing out. Does that mean? Is this mean? Is that mean? Are you trying to say this? Are you trying that? See, they should not do hard work like that. Is you have to identify maybe you are lacking of that. And this is kind of helping you from your old brain processing and develop to see that you want to try new way to improve yourself. So that's the key. We all have an area to improve. Then number 9, I want to remind everyone is becoming aware your drive to be loving as a whole, as united with your partner. And realize that each one of the you may be similar and maybe totally opposite, and how to respect that opposite side. How you become united. It's not agree everything what you say, what I say. It's more can be a civil conversation, say, you know, that's my perspective. What's your perspective? Okay, I kind of disagree with your perspective. What can we go from here? And that's the good start of the marriage. Number 10, I want to remind that we review that from past 2 workshop, is accepting the difficulty, creating a good marriage, because you make a conscious effort. And you have to realize you're really, really asking that person. It's not changing for you. It's they want to change it within themselves. Say, I want to be that person. I want to be there. And that's why I do it with you, for you. But eventually, it's the motivation to come from within. So I think last week, our slide, I think we talk about create a shared meaning, shared purpose and shared meaning, and connection in goals and life missions. So the main goal is, what's your life purpose? What's your life goal? Do you guys really share together? Because I think I am really focused on feedback to the society, that kind of person. I feel like what I have is God give me a way to serve the community. My husband, he has a different philosophy. It's the really. So he asked me, wow, you 3 weeks on the road, you really give this talk. He just said, you are really dedicated. I say, what I see is God called me for a purpose. And I truly believe that this is God give me the way to feedback to the church community. And I can share with you. And I'm hoping that you improve your marriage. And that's the goal. So I think the next one I want to really focus on that is that there are three things where your marriage is going to fall back. And last week that we talked about when there's a conflict, what should we do? So today I really want to emphasize on this one. One is blaming the others. That if you always point the finger at your partner, that marriage is going to fail very fast. Who would like to be blamed for everything? Correct? That doesn't make me feel good. Does that make you feel like, oh, I'm more powerful, I'm more superior? Well, no. See, we go back to, we are equal. I'm different from you. So blaming the others, you just make your partner feel like, wait, if I am God's children, you are God's children, and we are equal, then are you trying to play Jesus' role? Did you, on the Bible verses, did Jesus ever blame someone? You won't find it. No matter the Old Testament, New Testament. Because blaming is like I'm right, you are wrong, and it's all your fault. You make that person feel guilty. If that person starts to feel shame, guilty, you already lost that person. Just like you lost your child. If you shaming them, don't expect your child will close to you. Because that's how they build up their confidence. I'm a bad, I'm really not good. Lower. Did your partner feel like I have a God's image? When you shaming them, you actually shaming God and shaming Jesus. And that's the I want to bring up. You needed to hold your tongue back when you want to point out because it doesn't work. Second is the fallback measure is that you withdraw. You kind of just say, you know, forget it. Every time we talk, we argue. So I'm not going to, you kind of not physically withdraw, you kind of just silence treatment, and you kind of emotionally check out. Because that's the also deadly, deadly poison in the marriage. It's kind of you like, I leave you alone, like in a way, you are rejecting that person. And in a way, you kind of just say, you know, I have nothing to do with you. See? That person living in the dark. I know we have a fight. But right now, you are totally, including not want to sleep on the same bed. And we could... I'm not interested in sex. Don't touch me. See? It's deadly, very, very bad in a marriage. If you using that against your partner, I will ask you to stop it. If you really want to build an intimacy, by using withdrawal, it's not going to work in a long-term relationship. And number three, how you guys fall out in your marriage is that you are rushing to fix. You put so much effort, you want the problem solving, and you really don't want to talk about it. You just want to solve the problem, so you get moving. Just move on. But actually, maybe that situation, you guys need to sit down and talk about it. Because eventually, like I say, it's iceberg. You solve the top, but you didn't solve the bottom at all. Correct? And then this is going to grow. So I think this is the dangerous part that I see a lot of marriage. Feel like I cannot talk to my husband or I cannot talk to my wife because these three components, either one of them. So I want to encourage you. This is the part that we can do better job. So next one, it's that you lost the connections that between you two, then of course, one of the party is going to lose the voice. It doesn't matter what I say. He won't hear me or she won't hear me. It doesn't matter. Like my opinion doesn't matter anymore. This person making all the decisions for us. What the purpose? Correct? So what would make that? It's because we are moving so quickly, we acknowledge that each partner tried to say. So you say it before your partner say, this is what you mean. And I think last week I give you a very good the couple that I'm working with right now. You want to divorce me, did you? No. The husband is already jumped ahead. And the wife say, when did I say that? Then, of course, it's really, really, he just really, you put the money on your retirement, you did it, no. And he just keep go on and on and on. The wife would say, I put the money in retirement for the past 15 years. Why you just suddenly bring up this? Correct? Because he did not want the divorce. But he is pushing her out. He said, I know you are leaving me, so I'm going to force you to leave me. Second is then losing and regaining empathy. You no longer have empathy what your partner went through. Oh, here go again, your depression, or your mom's problem, your family problem. You lose that empathy for the other persons. You are not interested about that person's how the things pile up for them, there's an emotional struggle. You just kind of forget it. I had enough. Oh, you here go, you bring it up again. See? All this rolling eyes, all this. You lost that empathy. And that will lose the connection. And number three is that you bring out the hidden conversations. So say that you guys are really like in the bed, have a pillow talk, and then you bring up that, you used to say this to so-and-so, and that person say that you say this. And that. See, there's a break the confidentiality. Whoever people say out to the other person, you bring out to your conversations. It's like, that's what you say. I know that's what you say. That's what you mean. But that person is like, you take out of context. Correct? And that will bring down this communications. As you can see, each one of us, we all like to avoid conflict. Why? Because it makes us so uncomfortable. And sometimes it gets us going, and it's like we're frustrated, we're disappointed, we're angry, we are sad. See, all these negative emotions will come up. But that's why it's really important for us that I would like to spend some time today that really helping you guys. Brian, can you find the slide on the I message exercise, that one for me? Yes, thank you. So in the corporate world or in the a lot of psychology that we really emphasize I statements, okay, it's called I message. And this is like we are the partner. So you and your partner, that you guys are going to, you want to point out when you, that person's specific behavior or specific actions, not general. You always like that. Excuse me, what is always means? Okay? You always late. You always this. See, that's not good. When you are late for today's dinner, see, you bring it back to just focus on right now. And I feel, what's your emotion? A lot of, especially because if you guys are not very using the feeling words, is I think. Think is not equal to feelings. Think is logic. Feelings it come from your heart. Okay? So I feel anxious, I feel disappointed, I feel frustration, I feel edging, I feel, what's your feelings? We should not just have a basic of five feelings. We have more than that. Correct? Because you point out that person's specific behavior, actions, how that impact on you, I feel, then what's because that, it's like a really, that there's an end result you come from. And we want you to really focus on that. Sometimes you feel like I need to explain why I choose to do it, because the past conflict or past argument or past you point out, see, that's the past, the old result, and the impact on current. But we want to emphasize on next two, so I need, what do you need? I need you to hear me. I need you to stop. I need you to change. And change what? Specifically. Then if you really don't have any action, you want your partner to change, then you say, I want. What do you want? I want that we spend more time together. I want that we're doing things together. Not like you go to your gym and I are doing this and then we are not seeing each other. So what do you want? Expectations. Correct? So right now, I would like to each one of you to pair up with your partner, and I want you to really go back to something that the last week that really upsets you or disappoint you, or you get frustrated and you find that you are not being heard or you are not being, I want you to practice today. Okay. Started with, it's not that I'm nitpicking. So your marriage has a lot of problems, and then I want you to pick up every single one. No, I want you specifically choosing one. It's really, really that you are being bothered, that incident. Okay? So I'm going to give you 5 minutes. So let's practice this iMessage. Okay? So each person take 5 minutes, and the other person take 5 minutes. Partner, when someone is sharing, active listening. I would like you to just listen and acknowledge. Don't try to justify or try to problem solving. That's not what this exercise. It's just listening. Listen to that person's the whole message. Okay? Let's start. Okay, sorry. So how's everyone? Good. I think I was listening to this. I put them together, sorry. I think that, oh, they have a brotherhood bonding time. I really want to keep one thing that really important is that keep precise what you need, what you want, and because that's the really, the goal is if you come from two directions, you want to say what I need, what I want is because we want to join. We want to be together. We wanted to have the life not constantly back and forth, back and forth. And that's why it takes a conscientious effort to make that happen. So next slide, please, Brian. Okay. So there is one speaker. He is a very good communications. He's a theologian, and he's a David Asperger. He said that it's really, when someone want to communicate, because it's because of caring enough to hear and being heard. That's the key. Because you care so much, you want to hear them, you want to be heard. And this is a book that he published a long time ago that I want to, you guys to really, if you have a chance, it's very old, let me see. If it's a Chinese, it's, you can also buy it from the English version that he it's been translated. And it's very good, and you can take a look that he talked about how you care enough. One, we already know, active listening. And it's like a please say it one more time. I'm willing to listen. So it's not just like, okay, I'm looking my cell phone. Okay, honey, whatever you say, okay. That's not active listening. Active listening is drop everything, pay attention, please say it one more time. I'm sorry. Like, I give you a good example. Yesterday, I gave a talk in the American Heart Association's, like at 10 o'clock. And then I wake up, and I was like focused on what I'm going to talk, and I was like really in my zone, like a present. And then my husband is already on the exercise machine. And I was like, okay, I'm trying to do the things. I didn't hear him say, honey, don't prepare the breakfast. I'm not going to eat it. And I didn't hear a thing. Because I was so focused. I really don't. And he was like, I already told you. Now you are going to waste a breakfast. I said, oh, you just eat it. Later, as a lunch, correct? I'm not practicing what I preach. You know, I should say, yes, honey, you call me, You want to tell me something? I should be listening. Then second is like when we, our focus sometimes at in our relationship is our mind is 1,000 miles away. We are not really focused. You might worry about your kids, more worry about your project, worry about this, worry about that. And then it's like the pay attention is so hard. Like you don't believe it. When I was walking in, I see a lot of parents, the kids is tell the parents want something. The parent is not even pay attention and continue conversation with the other adults. I was like, oh, great. That we often do that. And then I think it's the goal is please try again. I am paying attention. If you say that you are really not paying attention in the first place, then just say, please try again. I'm paying attention now. Come back to it. And really is a listening. I'm willing to listen. I'm also that wishing that someone is listening to me. So it's not I'm just listening to you. I also want to be listening, correct? And that's the key. It's both way. And that makes that relationship is going to last longer. And next one is a parallel. It's equal. I want to be equal. And I listen to you with equal attitude. So I'm not already put down on you. I'm not judging you. I am not. I'm seeing us that you, me, we are equal. Yes, you might have a better knowledge on certain things, but doesn't mean you are above me. I should like pay respect to that, say, oh, you are like the other day I was laughing because I'm not technology very savvy person. Okay? And then so when I was doing the presentation, I was like, oh shoot, I don't know how to change this from this screen to that screen. It's like, it's frustrating. It's getting me nervous. And then this young kid come in, just, oh, you just do this, do that. And I really, really feel like, even though he is younger, I see him as equal. I respect that. He has something. He has his objective, subjective feelings, emotions. I can able to. And this is a really crucial one. Oftentimes, when we have a conflict, involve our children, it's because we don't treat them as equal. You are my kid. You listen to me. You don't know what you are talking about. I am the parent. I know what, see? If you using that method, treating your teenager, you guys are going to argue all the time. Why? Because they want you to know. Yes, I'm your children. Yes, I know I am still learning, but I'm exercise how to be a good, equal adult here. And in the developmental psychology say, teenager is because they are trying to find their identity. And how you can help them. What do you think? You want to hear what do you think? What do you feel? Because they feel like, okay, I am separate from my parents. We are on the same equal human being, that level. Next one is that take a risk. Is I wish to understand you and being understood. Sometimes we don't want to take a risk. Why? Because we are so afraid oh, here you go. We are going to have an argument. We are going to do this. We are going back to bring all things. We are See, we are not taking risk anymore. And then the more you are not taking risk, the more it's going to be a pattern, routine. The problem didn't resolve and still feeling hurt, still not feel respect. It doesn't serve the purpose for marriage. Correct? So, take a risk. It's that I am trying my best to communicate with you. I am going to keep trying. Let you know how I feel. I want to hear what, how you feel. See? Because the truth in the marriage counseling, oftentimes I find for all the experience of working with a couple, when the one partner say, I want a divorce, the other person, why? Really? You think it's really not happening? Actually, it happened a lot. You say, what's wrong with our marriage? I thought, well, our marriage is fine. Why you suddenly want a divorce? Because it's really become one-man show. That person dominated, then everything become routine. Then they just say, what the heck I'm doing? I want to find a partner, really partner. So in the past, that's the most difficult in the couple sessions. It's one person already make up their mind, I don't want to stay. The last one is care enough. I respect you same as I'm respected by you. That's called care enough. If you want to have a good communication, then you need to say, I respect you, you respect me. It's two-way, not always one way. Correct? So I think that, we talk about on he said that, how do you say it in the care enough circle? Is that you have to go come back to it. It's when something happened, when you did this, I feel being cared for. So one thing, what did your partner do that you feel being cared for? Shout out the answer. Acknowledge. Great. What else? What did when your partner did for you that you feel that being cared for? Yes, complete your task. Not being nag. Okay, what else? Problem solving, okay. Degree. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think that this is a good question. I think it's when men maybe look at the bigger picture. Like I think that's this couple. Like men look at the bigger picture, and maybe the wife is more detail oriented. So each both solve the problem, but it's just a different angle. And do you feel like well, I want to be appreciated because I'm looking for the bigger picture, or I am in the very specific, correct? But I think it's, why can't both say, we solve this issue together. That's the key. It's not you solve a majority, I solve a 20%. It's we solve the issue together. So I think, some of you that know that for the past 2 weeks, I have a severe allergy all year round, 24/7. So I am really like when I'm not well, my husband can tell. Then he said, "Oh no!" Like I come home from the hospital, he was like, "Oh no, you have a bad day." I can tell. Because he can just, based on my behavior, he knows I have a bad day. I feel being cared for by that way. Like, honey, I think you should sit down. Let me give you a glass of water. And then he will put the wet towel on my forehead to kind of cool me down, because the allergies actually helps in that way. So I feel like I'm being cared for. So what else is being cared for? Small things. Say that you are my neighbor, he is a plumber. He go to work every day, 4:30. 4:30, I was like, oh man. And his wife wake up same time with him, make his breakfast, pack his lunch, every day. And she is like taking care of the kids at home, those kinds of a daycare center. I really, really, I often joke with the husband. I say, you have a wonderful, wonderful wife. He say, I know. I feel that every morning when I'm eating that breakfast with that a fresh coffee in my mug that I can take to work side, I always being appreciated. That really, I appreciate that my wife. She doesn't have to, but she choose to. See, that's the difference. Next one is by what way I give my sincere caring. So yes, you can do house cleaning, washing clothes, laundry, cooking, washing dishes. But it's really, I give my sincere caring by small things. Like yesterday is my grandkids' the birthday party. You know, as grandparents, you just show up and bring the gift. That's really normally what we do. But in the party, I will help out, you know, clean up here, there, pick up the trash, all the kids, all the bloom they pop. It's like, you know, it's a never ending. So after I pick up, my husband say, thank you. Thank you for doing that. I really can see you are really, even though you didn't help my daughter doing all the prep, but you help clean up. So she doesn't have to do it on her own, see? So I choose to give my sincere caring small task. Next one, by learning something. I wish to continue to grow up as a person in caring. Correct? So, right now, I want you to hold your partner's hand. Okay. Don't worry, if they are sweaty, you can kind of Okay, I just want you learning the language, love language. I think your church will go through that five love language, correct? Physical contact, Okay. Touch. Right now, I want you to touch your partner's fingers and where is the wedding ring? Remind you. Ah! Or is that in other ways, say, you know, I'm not so sure I want to wear that. Okay, so tell me, holding together, how's that feelings? When you are dating, you hold your partner's hands more than right now. Exactly, it's because you want to have that connection. So every time you're holding your partner's hand, you say, I want to grow up as a person so I can carry you more. So in the wedding ceremony, remember the pastor will ask you, holding your both hand, put on your ring finger. That's exactly what that means. Correct? Okay. So the other way, don't drop it yet. By refusing, in your relationship, you are going to refusing something. I refuse to blame you. I refuse to critical on you, make a critical judgment on you. I refuse because I wish I can care you more. Yes, so you refusing is because there is a principle that you set up for your marriage. I refuse that we didn't talk about and go to bed. I refuse withdraw. I refuse blaming. I refuse because I want to care more. Well, that's you are missing the last sessions. It's the validations, appreciations. Okay? You can watch the, they have a video. I want you to encourage that. No, that's not true. Yes, because I think it's more. Every day you do that more, the more you want to love that person. Hey, please do not shame in this person, okay? I'm glad he made it today. That's all I care. Next one is I am craving for more caring, okay? I'm craving for more caring, and then I will. So you have to really looking for that opportunity. How do you really care for your partner? Craving for that. Not just sex, not just intimacy. It's a craving for make that person feel like, oh, I'm being loved, I'm being cared for. And that's the key. Do you craving in your relationship that something to spark? Next one is when you are craving for more caring, please, like a really that doing this process, you want to keep your partner in the loop, not just to focus on your end. Communicate with your partner. That's the key. It's the really continuum. So I think that this is that my gift for you. Oh, I really appreciate that all these 3 weeks that you guys keep coming back, because I do see you choose to love your partner. That's why you are here. And you choose to make that commitment. I am stay. I'm not going to give up. I will try my best. I will keep doing that. And that's because the love behind it. So, appreciation. Remember, on our first week, we talk about appreciation. So right now, I want you to really, one, give you the really couple minutes, because since day one, the week one, to up till today, your learning is growing. In the past, you might just appreciate that you cook, you appreciate that, the very basic. Right now, I want you to spend a couple minutes, really mean it, and holding your hands, look into your partner in the eyes, say, I appreciate. What do you appreciate? Okay? Let's take a couple minutes. Go ahead. So I wanted to really, on the slide, the appreciations, adorations. I think I was sitting with this gentleman. Like, it sounds like the wife is really dedicated her time with the kids. And then took the kids to all the sports events. Soccer, practice, all this. I think it's, see, you want to say it. Honey, I adore your dedication. I adore your resilience. I adore. What is the person's strength that you really look up to that person and say, I really adore you. Next one that I say, the encouragement, say, because we all human. Sometimes we might want to do something, but we just like, what a dreadful. So I was encouraged, like that. I heard you want take our son, take our kids to the soccer game. And I will do whatever I can. I can pack the soccer ball to your car. I will remind you. I would really, sometimes, we all need that a little bit encouragement. Don't you agree? Because that encouragement can go far, far away. On Paul's letter to Timothy, just like, keep going. We are doing God's work. Keep going. Encouragement. Even though in the midst of all these tribulations, keep doing. Correct? So in your partner's life, you want to encourage that person, because they might see, oh, my life dream, my life goal is not going to fulfill. But you want to say, it's okay. Let's journey together. Correct? It's not the end result, the destination. It's about the process that counts. So I think that this is the really that I want to keep remind you. So when we have a conflict, first thing is, what is the conflict? You want to ask yourself, what is the conflict? Because you guys have a different value. You haven't talked about it, correct? I grew up a very poor family. So my value is that money is not everything. Money is just a transaction. But it's how we stick together as a family that counts. So if you got into the argument with your partner, and you guys have a really, really hard time resolve it, ask yourself, what exactly I'm really insist? If you really let this problem continue, what would the end result? Or maybe you just want to make the point, I want to be heard. I want to be cared. I want to be respected. See, that's the principle, correct? So you need to have that conversations. So Pastor Doris want me to leave a lot of room for the question and answer, because I think it passed two times. I kind of really didn't run out of time. But I want to really, that some people ask me the question, I wrote it down. So I'm going to really answer some of your questions. So the person that asked me how to reach the mutual agreement. So I don't know that the agreement is all about, but I want you to keep one thing in mind. It's not that you are right, I'm wrong. It's we both can be right, can be both, we can be wrong. Can you see that possibility? Exactly. So is there a room to really say, what's going on here? Pause before you continue argue, because you might lose. What's the first place you got into that argument? Is it the value? Or is it because the love expression, that what you really asking, that person cannot satisfy you? Then how are you going to make that person know? So that's the first. Second is that respectful communication. What's been respectful communication? Since you guys have been here for 3 weeks, what's been the respectful communication? Willing to listen? Active listening. Don't get angry when you try to communicate. Okay. Look at the intention behind the words. I think also respectful communication is that I see I'm communicating with my partner. We are equal, but we are not the same. That's the key. You don't see that person is lower. You see that person as it is, correct? The other one is anger management. So I think on the first session I talk about anger management. I say, what right do you have to yell someone, berate someone? What right do you have to, when you are angry, point out someone? I hope you have a good justification in Jesus. If Jesus asks it, what right do you have, my son, my daughter? What right? If Jesus, what Jesus right, clean out the temple, all the Pharisee, all the table, why? He say, why do you put all this into my God's temple? See, that's a righteous anger. You have to ask yourself, would you say that to Jesus? When you say to your partner, would you dare to say that to Jesus? It's not anger is wrong. No, that's not what I mean. But what is anger you? You need to go deeper. Not just want to prove I'm right, you are wrong. But go deeper. Why I am so angry about? Maybe it's my value, my life purpose, my self-respect being violated. What is justified anger? So right now, like I don't want to bring up political world. All this anti-Asian movement, that get me so angry. What right do you have to think that you are about me? No way. What right do you have to push someone to cause body injury and then to really kick some homeless people? What right do you have? Just because they are homeless, that doesn't mean you have every single right. Because they are human, you are human, equal. So you have to ask yourself, what's the reason I'm so angry? Maybe you are not being heard. Maybe your voice being shut down. Maybe you are being violated as a respect. Maybe you are being insulted. And maybe you are being blamed for something that you never do. Correct? So you need to ask yourself, and it's really this intensity. I think it's the most scary thing in the couple is intensity. If you put the other person in that fear, you already lost the love. In the New Testament say, love, there's no fear. But if your relationship, there is a fear component, you need to ask. That means I'm showing this person to scare me. Then that person is unable to love, to grow. Correct? I used to teach domestic violence class and around the victim a group. Oftentimes they would tell me, I just did that person. As a victim, they just feel like if I say more, then they get more angry. Then the more they get angry, the more I'm in the corner. There's no way I can run. So it's already imbalanced, correct? But if I encourage you in the first session, God created you and your partner equal. If you put the fear of God in the first priority, this should not happen. Because you always, it's like, oh, shoot, I have to stand in front of God to say, explaining my behavior. Man, how difficult it is. God, I'm sorry. I just lash out. God say, what's the reason you have that? To support your lash out. And I think that's the first session when I go back to your childhood that you really witness how your parents play out the anger part. Correct? You see your parents, how they manage anger. Then that's how you manage your anger. Or you learn from someone how you manage your anger. So anger management is quite toxic. So if you can think about it, anger creates a fear. fear creates silence, anxiety, then that marriage is on the crumble. It's not on the solid ground. You can stay in the marriage, but you never feel love, being careful, then that's a fake marriage. Next one, someone is like, how you reconcile after the big conflict. So I think that from each one of you, you must reconcile in the past, correct? But how you reconcile? I think it's the I statement earlier I have you guys practice. A lot of people say, I won't forgive that person doing. I won't. If you hold that grudge, then the marriage is encounter a big barriers in that relationship. Then how are you going to do encounter? You have to chip away that rock. Correct? Because they constantly will come back to that big incident you guys fight. So, reconcile is not easy. Why? Because it's cumulative. It's not just one incident. Actually, it normally is here, there, it started to pile up. So once that big incident happened, big conflict happens, then you want to kind of take off everything. That's not easy. Okay? So right now, I want you to, maybe 2 minutes, I want you to ask your partner something you did that you are asking for forgiveness. Just really, between you two, just say something. I'm sorry I created the fear in your eyes. I can feel it. Your body tell me. Like you tense up, please forgive me. Maybe it's your tone of voice. Okay? So please, if something that your partner do and you want to ask for forgiveness, that doesn't mean you completely forgive that person. You just like, this is a first step. Okay? Okay. I hope that this is the first step that you guys try to talk it out. Okay? And if that same conflict happen again, you want to ask your partner, honey, I'm sorry that this is going to happen again. I don't know. I don't know what to do with it. Say it. Because I think the next person asking is how to avoid that become a big fight. But I want to ask you is, what is holding back to communicate? What's holding back? Why you are holding back your reserve, your love and care for your partner? I think we all have a repentance here to need to do in front of God. We fail our partner. We fail God want us. Love is patient. Love is kind. We fail to admit it in front of God. Last one is that someone asked me about what happened if your partner and you have a different material values. You have a big house, I have a small house. And I would ask you, really, in God's kingdom, is really that's what God looking for? Not driving Tesla won't kill your life in God's kingdom. You drive the Civic, God still welcome you. Correct? But why this material value is so crucial? I want to impress people. I want to earn, I want to gain people's respect. That means you are not respecting yourself. Oh, I have to buy the Gucci. I have to wear something like a fabulous. For me, I will encourage you. God see this as rubbish. Correct? I think it's more what makes you feel comfortable. What makes you feel this is what God wants me to feel. But not about come from the selfish. I want to prove. Then that's already wrong. Because you don't need to prove anything in God's kingdom. God said, beloved, you are my child. You come to me naked. You born naked. Why you want to kill me in all this life of material things? And you are fighting over material things. That's even more insane. I think it is a good principle. If you want to buy something, I do this all the time, is that, like my car got, I have the accident in the October last year, and then my car got ruined it. And I really asking God, so God, what, can you prepare a car for me? So I have, right now I'm driving my in-laws car because they just say, well, we are, because they both passed away and then they are old car. I was like, you know, as long as you can drive, get me to the destination. I don't need a new car. And I just really, my husband just said, but safety, because it is 2006. And he's like, I don't want you, something happened in the freeway, then something might happen. I say, well, I'm praying God to show me, like which car I should get, and which car that you feel like I, give me really, for just for transportation. It's not for anything else. I don't need to have like impress anyone. What the hell? God say, I don't need your impressions, correct? So I want to ask you, if you, your spouse have that tendency, you need to ask God for help because only God can change that person's mind. I really do. If you ask my husband, like I like to go to garage sale, I like to go to thrift store, I feel like so many things wasted. I want to promote recycle, reuse. Okay? So, Brian, can you put down the last slide? So, I would like to everyone, by end of our 3 weekends workshop with a prayer, and that's all read out loud. Dear God, may my spiritual eyes can see clearly. May my ear can hear and understand completely and hear the words from the deepest heart speaking. Amen. I want you to hear your husband, your wife. I want you to really open your eyes, open your ears, open the spirit speaking to you. Come from the heart. And thank you so much.